Father in heaven, we come to your presence once again this morning. We're very thankful, Lord, for the opportunity of coming to worship your name in your house. But we pray now, Lord, that you may inspire us, each one of us, as we serve and as we present our worship to you. Please receive our adoration. Clean our hearts. Purify us at this moment, I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I would invite you all to sing with me the hymn 524. Would you please sing?
God spoke to her, and he wanted something. someone to kind of go over scriptures and his thoughts and his feelings, deliver them to us. And he chose this little lady, Ellen G. White. And she has written so many books. In fact, this book was written over 112 years ago. She passed away not too far before my dad was born. But the words in the book were on chapter 39, the knowledge received through God's word. It was written for times back then, and it's written definitely for times right now. And it could have been written and studied and read for times when I was born. But some words just never fail and always have a meaning too. The whole Bible, she says, directed from God, is a revelation of the glory of God in Christ. Received, believed, obeyed, it is the great instrumentality in the transformation of the character. It is the grand stimulus, the constraining force that quickens the physical, mental, and spiritual powers, directs the life into right channels. The reason why the youth and even those of mature years are so easily led into temptation and sin is that they do not study the Word of God and meditate upon it as they should. The lack of firm, decided willpower, which is manifest in life and character, results from neglect of the sacred instructions of God's Word. They do not, by earnest effort, direct the mind to which would improve holy thought, diverted from that which is impure and untrue. There are few who chose the better part, who sit at the feet of Jesus, as did Mary, to learn of the divine teacher. Few treasure his words in their heart and practice them in their life. The truths of the Bible received will uplift the mind and the soul. If the word of God were appreciated as it should be, both the young and the old would possess an inward recitative, a strength of principle that would enable them to resist temptation. Let men teach and write the precious things of the Holy Scriptures. Let the thought and the attitude, the keen exercise of brain power, be given to the study of the thoughts of God. Study not the philosophies of man's conjectures, but study the philosophy of him who is the truth. No other literature can compare with this in value. The mind that is earthly finds no pleasure in the contemplation of the Word of God, but for the mind renewed by the Holy Spirit, divine beauty, celestial light shine from the sacred page, which to the earthly mind was a desolate wilderness, to the spiritual mind becomes a land of great streams. The knowledge of God as revealed in His Word is the knowledge to be given to our children. From the earliest dawn of reason, they should be made familiar with the name of the life of Jesus. Their first lesson should teach them that God is their Father. Their first training should be that of loving obedience. Reverently, tenderly, let the word of God be read and repeated to them in proportions suited for their comprehension and adapted to awaken their interest. And above all, let them learn of his love revealed in Christ and its great lesson. And in John, 1 John 4:11, it says, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. Let the youth make the word of God the food of mind and soul. Let the cross of Christ be made the science of all the education, the center of all teaching and all study. Let it be brought into the daily experience and practical life. So that will the Savior become to the youth a daily companion and friend, every thought will be brought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. With the Apostle Paul, they will be able to say in Galatians 6:14, God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I to the world. Thus through faith they come to know God by experimental knowledge. They have proved for themselves the reality of his word, the truth of his promises. They have tasted, and they know that the Lord is good. It is our privilege to reach higher and still higher for the clear revelings of the character of God. When Moses prayed, "I beseech thee, show me thy glory," the Lord did not rebuke him, but granted his prayer. God declared to his servant, and in Exodus 33:18 and 19, "I will make all my goodness pass before thee, and I will proclaim the name of the Lord before thee." I'm just reading parts of the chapter, and some of this book was my mother's, and she has underlined some of this, and she underlined this. Our life work here is a preparation for life eternal. The education begun here will not be completed in this life. It will be ongoing through all eternity, ever progressing, never completed. More and more fully will be revealed the wisdom and the love of God in the plan of redemption. The Savior, as he leads his children to the fountains of living water, will impart rich stores of knowledge. And they, by the waters, will impart rich stores of knowledge. And day by day, the wonderful works of God, the evidence of his power, is creating and sustaining the universe, will open before the mind its new beauty. In the light that shines from the throne, mysteries will disappear, and the soul will be filled with astonishment at the simplicity of the things that were never before comprehended. Now we see through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now we know in part, but then we shall know even as also we are known. That's a promise. That's a wonderful thing to look forward to when we get to heaven. I'm eager to learn all that I can learn. This is a little poem my husband wrote back in January of this year to the members and to our church little family. "Attention, ye Christians, take heed of the storm. This world is in turmoil and not close to norm. We study our Bibles. The future is clear. Have total commitment, not clouded with fear. Let's all look to heaven and pray for our church. Seek the Lord daily. Don't give up the search. No time for excuses or sins we may hide. If you feel discouraged, we stand by your side." I love this church family and feel so blessed. My thoughts and intentions I have confessed. May you have a happy Sabbath.
Amen.
Our scripture reading today is John chapter 8, verse 32. "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." You know, as we have talked many times, we must, each one of us, have a personal saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. I'd like to do what we have done the last few times, that everybody that can would kneel, and we'll have just a few seconds of silence, and you could commune with the Lord, commune with him, bringing your petitions, but also asking what he would have you to do, and asking things in your life that need to be changed. So let's have just a few seconds of silence. Father in heaven, you just heard from your children, Lord. We pray for each and every one here, and also for each and every one that isn't here. We know we live in perilous times, Lord. You know, you told us these things were coming. We know we have to stay in your word every day. We know we have to be strong in you. Otherwise, we could be in trouble. But thank you, Lord, for all you've done for us. Be with Sarah now. She brings us your undiluted message, Lord. Send your Holy Spirit and your angels. We can't thank you enough just for the precious gift of life. We say these things in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Child behaved bad, and they say, my child is good. No, no, no.
They could see through Mark when he would misbehave, but when he was truthful. And they knew he wasn't saying any lie. It's good when we can build up our character in such a way that people can tell if we're lying or not. And that was Mark's case. Next day, the parents received a letter from Mr. John complaining about Mark's dishonesty, but his parents didn't even open the letter. They put it in the fire right away. They didn't want to hurt the feelings of that boy anymore. They knew he didn't do anything wrong. So they just got Mark together and they prayed with him and they said, "Son, you know, being a Christian, you need to be like Christ. So if you're being mistreated, learn a lesson with it. How did Jesus react when he was mistreated? Did Jesus do anything wrong? Did he hurt anyone? He was being accused and accused to be killed. It's not your case. So think positively. You're being a Christian. You're being like your master. Don't be afraid. Jesus will be just when justice comes up to light. Just do your best. Don't talk about Mr. John to anyone. You don't need to defend yourself. Just do what is right and people will know you." Well, time kept going. And Mr. John had already spread all over around about Mark and about what he had done. So he had already told many people about what the boy had done, even though he didn't do that. Well, one day, he was surprised. Mark was surprised about something that happened. Mr. Andrew came to Mark and said, "Hey Mark, would you like to come and work for me?" And Mark asked, "Mr. Andrew, haven't you heard the story of my lunchbox and the wallet? Haven't you heard the things that are going on yet? Didn't you hear Mr. John talking about his wallet stuff?" And Mr. Andrew just answered, "Yes, I heard it. And you know what? I have been watching you throughout that. Even though you know it's not true, you haven't been defending yourself around the town. Even though you know you didn't do it, you kept silent and you kept a good attitude. I appreciated that." Now he was puzzled. How come Mr. Andrew knows it is not true if I have never talked to him before? How come everybody's telling that about me, but he still believes what I didn't even tell him yet? The mystery was solved. Finally, Mr. Andrew said, "You know what? I was right there when it happened. It wasn't you. It was your dog. I was just coming out of my house on that day. I had to go shop somewhere. And I saw your dog coming out with his wallet in the mouth and dropping it by your lunchbox. I didn't know what it was all about until I heard the story. Then I recognized it wasn't him. It was his dog. Maybe Mr. John lost the wallet somewhere. The dog found it and brought it to the safest place he thought. You didn't do it. I know you didn't do it. And because you were faithful to the truth, you're the best one to work in my property." Tears came to his face, but he knew justice was made. Mr. Andrew made sure to clarify to everyone he crossed with, Mark was not a thief. Mark was an honest boy. And he just had to hold to the truth. When we have any problems, we just have to focus to the truth. And that's the reason why I picked this subject for today. Because with the world as we have it nowadays, the truth became subject. Became a more or less thing. Oh, that's half of the truth, so it is true. But half of the truth is not true. And many people run the risk to swear. And we will see that in a moment. You know what? This world made the lie a fairy tale. We learned that Pinocchio is a nice guy. He's a cutie little guy. And just because his nose grows up when he lies, he didn't stop being a nice little guy. He even smiles when his nose is too big because it's just a little lie. It's not a big deal. But that's how our kids are growing in this society. They're growing with the thought that is not a big deal. they kind of start growing over and believing in this little fairy tale to their own lives. I can say the truth and my nose and lie about the truth, and sometimes my nose will grow a little bit and I will see how did Pinocchio feel. Even though it will never happen, it's kind of a time where kids in early life start playing with the truth. They say a little bit of the truth, but then they kind of make up the rest of the story, and doctors even come and say that it's kind of a fake age. The kids fake things. Well, I tell you what, I wasn't able to fake too many things. I got pepper in my mouth real quick when I would fake something right there. And I learned a lesson, no faking is allowed. The truth and the truth alone. I still remember those days that my dad would say, is that true? Yeah, that's true. And then when he would find out, next thing I would see was that beautiful red spoon come to my mouth. Said, the lie burns, my daughter, the lie burns. I'll never forget how much that burns. Anyway, if we don't take care, and if we don't take measurements, they will grow older from that little time of fake age, and that will be taken with them through the adult lives. And that moving towards the adult lives will bring that feeling like, well, you know, it's a good reason. I'm lying, but it's a good reason. I have a good purpose after all. I'm not hurting anyone. I mean, it's just a little thing nobody will ever know. You know? People forget that it's all about character. I was searching, when I was preparing, when I was thinking about this, I was searching in the internet about truth, about lie, and I found some interesting images about that that I want to share with you. Look at that. Secrets and lies kill relationships. No matter how careful you are, you will get caught. No matter how careful you are. There's another sentence, that one I didn't find in the internet, but I heard once. I'd rather say, and I took it for myself, I really did. I'd rather say always the truth, because I never have to make a big effort to know what I said last time. You know? When we lie, we have to kind of catalog, when did I say that and to whom? Because then when I have to talk to that person again, I have to get the trend of the lie. If I always say the truth, I don't have that fear. I said the truth. Whatever I have to say again will be with that. There is another one. And this one particularly, I like very much. If you tell the truth, it becomes a part of your past. If you tell a lie, it becomes a part of your future. It will be with you for the time you live. I remember Daniel already told this story once, but it comes handy with this topic, and I'm going to say it again. You know the story about that lady, and that is a true story. It really happened. I'm not going to give too many details for the sake of the live stream. Maybe it comes to people who knows the personalities of this story. But the story itself is already strong enough. It was this lady that was in the back of this church one of these days, not this one, a church one of these days, and they were just about to have communion when the pastor is up front and they were just going to move forward, and this lady just stands up and she says, honey, things cannot keep on going that way. We gotta tell them all. And the pastor is puzzled, the wife is even more puzzled. What are you talking about? We can't keep on that for ourselves. Everybody needs to know we have an affair. The wife of the pastor fell aside right away. She fainted right there. And the pastor said, what are you talking about? Do you understand what you're doing? She said, no, come on, don't keep up faking that. Everybody needs to know. And the pastor was so shocked until the point that she said, it is true. I know you have a birthmark somewhere in a private part that nobody would see. Then everybody was shocked. How would she know if it is not true? Finally, that man lost his credentials, lost his job. He's no longer a pastor. The wife left him because it was too much for her to carry. Kids were growing away from daddy. He was concerned because he knew it wasn't true. And his aunt, he knew he had done nothing. But she could say things that nobody else could. How could it happen? Finally, one day, that lady, maybe 20, 30 years later, that lady is in bed. She's about to die. And she calls this pastor. And she says, I really need to talk to you. And he just wanted to know what it was. And she says, I need to apologize. I made it all. I couldn't help. You were in the hospital a couple days before that happened, or weeks. And as I was in the hospital as a nurse or whatever she was doing there, I uncovered you and I saw that. And I couldn't help. I really felt like making a big novel out of it, and I couldn't help. I made that story. So I really wanted to apologize for that because I feel guilty. Well, he got his credentials back. He could become a pastor again. What about those 30 years? What about his family? What about his children who were raised against him and far from him? That lie destroyed a family. So this lie became part of the future of that woman who just had a novel in her head and decided to make a story. Was it worthy? Did she gain anything out of it? No. But sometimes we go too far with our own imagination. Let's say, how would you like to go to the doctor? You know you're sick, Brenda. Just imagine, you went to the doctor, you had a problem, okay? How would you like your doctor to lie to you? He sees that you're in the red line, but he says, well, you know, you're fine. Just, you know, keep watching this and that. Would you like to know the truth at all costs? How much would you love the truth for real? Or do we love the truth when it's about someone telling me the truth, but if I have to tell the truth, that's another subject, right? If we are the doctor, we really want to know the truth because it may cost our life if we don't know the whole truth. Do we care about the truth that much when we are talking about it? It's such a subject. Truth, it's so simple, but it's so complex at the same time. We all tend to have those little tiny lies that we so-called little lies, but they may cost our own salvation. Because one of the commandments says, thou shalt not lie. And if it is written in the stone, should it be serious? I had never been in court before, but this picture, I took it. It was the first time I was in court. It was 2 weeks ago. No, I had no problem. I had not to go to court for my own. I just gave a ride to some friends. But I was impressed. I had never been in court before. I had never gotten to that room before. And, you know, it was impressive. When the man opened the door and he started walking in, he said, everybody stand up. And everybody stands up, really quiet, no noise. The judge comes in, he sits down, you may be seated. So much reverence. And he's a human being. How much less reverence we have sometimes to come to the presence of God, right? But that's another subject. Just think about it. In the courtroom, it's such a serious environment. You know that depending on what you say, you may have a good consequence or a bad one. Depending on what you say, you may go to jail or you may be set free. It's such a serious environment. But you know what? Even so, we still have some moments that we doubt about the classifying swearing thing. This week, we have been having such a turmoil in this country about the truth. Who is saying the truth after all? Both of them are swearing. Both of them are saying the truth and the truth alone. But who is saying the truth? Do we know? Are we able to judge over that? How can we look at man and say, this is the truth? I'm not trying to be brain politic here. But think about it. We depend on men who are unjust, and we have to trust them many times. Because that's it. That's law. How much do we really trust our king, the King of Kings? How much do we follow the law he gave us? Who would be saying the truth? Mr. President or Mr. Former FBI Director? And this is a simple thing on earth. This is not talking about eternal life. It's not talking about anything after this. That's where our text comes in. Ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth shall make you free. Knowing the truth, and this is a moment where I would like you to think deeply about it. When the Bible says, uses the verb know, I don't know if you have ever read, but if you would just go to Genesis 4:17, the Bible says, sorry, and Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch. Have you ever read that? And it says, and Adam knew Eve, and Abraham knew Sarah, and she brought, didn't they know their wives before? They just got to know them? You know what that means? It means the intimacy with that person. When Cain knew his wife, they became one. The two became one. It was an intimate relationship. When it says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free, or shall make you free. You and the truth shall be one. It may be so intimate with you that it will make you free. Now, what is that truth? Right? What is that truth? There are a couple of Bible stories that happen in court, but I would like us to focus on the most impressive one of all. And I know you know what I'm talking about. It's found in John 18 from 33 to 38. And I would invite you to open right there. And we will just pass through it real quick. And it says like this. 33, John 18, 33 to 38. And it says, then Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, art thou the king of the Jews? Jesus answered him, sayest thou this thing of thyself, or did others tell it thee of me? In other words, are you saying that from your own, or did anybody tell you that? Right? Pilate answered, am I a Jew? Thy own nation and the chief priests have delivered thee into me. What hast thou done? Now Jesus answers, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not from hence. Pilate therefore said unto him, art thou a king then? Jesus answered, thou sayest, I am a king. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, that I should bear witness unto the truth. Everyone that is of the truth heareth my voice. Pilate said unto him, what is true? And when he had said this, he went out again unto the Jews and said unto them, I find in him no fault at all. Why didn't he find any fault in Jesus? Because he was the truth. Because he was so much one with the truth that he was the truth. And when Pilate asked this question, you know, I bet this question was mainly in his mind because he was so filled up around with lies. There's so many people. The Jews are lying about these men. I didn't find any guilt on him. His people are lying about him. There's so much lie about here. I bet he was just like, oh, truth? What is truth? It's a question. What is truth? There's so much lie. Everybody says their own lies, and they want me to believe on it. And you tell me, and you come and tell me that I should bear witness unto the truth, and everyone that is of the truth heard my voice. This is placing him in a very hard position. Because as you know, And if you read the whole story, I really would invite you to read this whole story, you know. Many times when I go into battles with my own sins, with my own difficulties, with my own shortcomings, I like to come to this story. This is the moment where I can see my Savior and how would he deal with little things like mine. His things are bigger than any of mine. So this is, I would invite you to read this. And as you focus on this story, you will recognize that Pilate, he was having a struggle, many struggles. He was having the first struggle. He didn't find any fault on that man who was being called to be crucified. And the crucifixion for those days, it was something serious. It was something deep. For you to be crucified, you really had to have done something beyond the limits. I mean, they had prisons, right? For you to get to the cross, you really had to be a criminal. And now, these people are calling this man to be crucified, and he comes to my presence, and he looks like a king. Something's weird. He was struggling with that. Now, second struggle. His wife had told him, she had dreamt a dream that was disturbing her, and she woke up and wrote a letter to her husband saying, "Much I suffer through the night because of that man. Do not touch him." If you read the story, we'll show you. But still, he wasn't strong enough. The pressure, what we usually call nowadays the peer pressure, right? The pressure was so strong that he could not recognize that he was going with lies. He was even lying to himself. When he comes with Jesus to that place, to spank him, he already knew he shouldn't touch the man. He didn't find any fault. If you don't find a fault in a man, why would you spank him? Right? He was trying. He was puzzled. What would I do with this situation? I don't want to lose my position. I have a high position here. Just imagine if Caesar hears that I didn't do anything and these folks start getting pressure on him. Then maybe he even thought, well, if they're lying about him, they may go and lie about me. When I was a kid, my parents always said, I don't know if you have such a saying in your language, but in my language there's a saying that says something like this: the lies have short legs. You know what I'm saying? So it doesn't run too fast. You always catch it first. So don't lie. It has short legs. In this case, he had already caught the lie. He had already knew what was true, but he was afraid. And Jesus was stuck to the truth. And as you see the rest of the story, when Pilate comes out and says, "What do you want me to do with him? I don't see any problem in the man." And they come and say, he said many blasphemies. He said he's the Son of God. Now he's puzzled. He comes in real quick and says, "Who are you?" Now he's afraid. "What is the truth? I need to know. Are you really a Son of God?" Jesus is in silence. He's in anger. What about if he really kills the Son of God? Will God be angry with him? Because in that particular, you know, situation, the Romans, they had their gods. And they would be scared about hurting a god. And now this man comes and he's the Son of God, and these people are claiming for me to kill him, and I see no fault in him. I already spanked him. They still want me to crucify him. If he would only know the truth, so the truth would set him free from all the burden. We all know what he did. In all his struggles, he said, "You do whatever you want. I wash my hands. His blood is not on my hands. I didn't do it." But he did. What he did was something. But now, his question had an answer. Jesus had already answered his question when he prayed for us in John 17:17, and he says, "Sanctify them." Who are them? You know the prayer. Jesus is praying for his disciples, and his prayer's extension was until us. He's praying for Michelle. He's praying for Justin. He's praying for Rebecca. He's praying for each one of us here. He's praying for Franklin Church. "Father, sanctify them through the truth." Thy truth, thy word is truth. He's saying, sanctify them. by your word. Unite your people. Unite your servants, my disciples, in your word. And that's what we were talking about in the Sabbath school. That is the topic that we were even covering. If things that are said from anyone is not according to the word, that is not sanctifying us to the truth. And that's where we have to stand for. It doesn't matter who is saying. It doesn't matter the degree, the level, the age, the status, unless it is according to the word. Because Jesus prayed for us today. He knew what we were going to pass through today. The word is being distorted a lot. Each one grabs their Bible and says, this means this. And the other one says, no. I see that differently. This means this. But that's why we have not only one, not only two, not only five, but we have 66 books between these covers. Because the Bible is a little here, a little there, and you find the truth. And that's why it's a hidden treasure. Only those who seek will find. And those who seek with all their heart. It's not just about reading your Bible once in a while. It's not just about even reading your Bible every day. Because many can read the Bible. I'm sure you know the devil reads his Bible. Because he wants to be aware of the signs so he may fake his own. Now, if he reads his Bible, is he sanctified? No, because he's not by the truth. Many people use the word of God for their own convenience. We must be sanctified by the truth and the truth alone. King David had already said as well in Psalms 119. I would also invite you, as I was reading through Psalms 119, the whole Psalms is so deep, so precious about the word of God and the truth. It's very, you have many, many verses in that big chapter that leads you to the truth. And it says, thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. He was calling your attention for the truth and the righteousness of God. And now let's see, what is the righteousness? Right in the same Psalm 119, 142, it says, thy righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, and thy law is the truth. Again, the righteousness of God is revealed to his word and through his law. That's why he gave us his law, so that he could cover us with the freedom we were talking about. If we only would have followed his law, we would be free from the burden of sin. Because his law and his righteousness are true. And the true will make you free. Knowing that, I would like to move forward with what is the law, what is the commandments. And he says, Psalm 119, again, as you see, he covers a lot in only one chapter. He says, 119, 151, thou art near, O Lord, and all thy commandments are true. He didn't say some of your commandments. Says all your commandments are true. If you just follow them, you will be set free. It's a granted promise. We just need to be focused on it for real. We need to believe on that. Now, if we would get the commandments of God, we would say, well, I agree with this one and I agree with that one, but you know, that one doesn't fit that well. You know, society have evolved and has changed. And many things are different nowadays, but have you noticed that most of our human laws come from God's laws right away? We all agree that you shall not steal, unless the ones who want to steal, those don't agree, right? But everyone, common sense, I don't want anybody to come and steal my house. I don't want anybody to come and steal anything from me or rob my car or my house, whatever, right? So we all agree that one commandment could jump right away to our human law. Everybody agrees, unless the ones who want to do it, that we should not commit adultery. Because, I mean, my spouse is mine. I didn't get married to share, right? I supposedly got married to have you in mind, and we don't want that to happen. So we would be happy if that commandment would jump right there. We are all agreeing that you shall not kill. Right? For a person to get to a point that it agrees, the person agrees to kill, something is wrong with that mindset. But we all agree that you shall not kill. So we are fine. Let's jump this one right there. It's fine. But then if we come on into other things like you shall not use the name of the Lord in vain, that's not a big deal. I mean, everybody shouts out loud, oh my God, here, and things like that, and nobody thinks it's a big deal. Aren't we breaking something more serious than the human law? This is made by human beings. That is made by God, the creator of human beings. So if he told us that, couldn't that be serious and maybe more important even? Wow, come on, that was back then when, you know, people were different. And we tried to accommodate the law for us. Again, as we were talking in the Sabbath school, to me the truth and the light is a matter of light. What would you prefer? If you are in a dark room and you're afraid of stepping somewhere, falling, or getting hurt, would you prefer to have a little light or a big one? If you had a chance to choose, if you are in a tunnel and it's all dark, how much would you like to have a bright light that would show you all the way so that you wouldn't be caught by anything, you wouldn't be hurt, you wouldn't fall aside? How much would light be important to you? That's how I would see the truth. How much is the truth really important to you in your life? Again, let's imagine you're driving. I pass through it. I rather drive during the day. I don't know about you, but I rather drive during the day. I can see the sides. I can see if any animals are coming to the road. I don't feel the danger of somebody is hiding behind the bush, and if I pass, they will jump into the middle of the road and cha-da! You know? I like to see it. So light is precious during the day. But what about during the night? Have you ever had a chance to drive and your lights are very dim, very little, and you're struggling to see and you have to go very slow because you're not seeing enough? You feel danger, don't you? That's how I would imagine if we wouldn't have the truth of God in our lives. We're in danger. Look at that. If you consider, God has given you instructions about how to live your life in a healthy way. If you have that light, you enjoy the freedom of having good health and doing everything that you want to do with your own bodies. Now, if you don't know that truth and you live your life according to what the world stands for you, you may be slave of an illness that you can't get rid of. You may be slave of the pills that the doctors tell you that if you don't take, you fall apart. Isn't that good, the freedom of the truth, the light on our road? We are just driving and we need light so that we can move forward. And the more light we use, the more light God gives us. Follow the right path. In Philippians 4:8, we are told as Christians that whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue, and if there be any praise, think of these things. Do you recognize it says, think of these things? He didn't say act according to these things. Do you know why he said that? Because after all these centuries and studies and science, it was already understood what God meant with this. It was understood that we are built by our minds. What we think becomes us. It's already understood that the thought leads to an action. That's why when Jesus comes and he says, if you think of a woman in the wrong way, you already committed adultery. Why? Because he already gave the start point on his mind. As you think, you turn to actions. If you act according to that for a flesh, they're not going to be needed. being bought, brought to life. In My Life Today, page 250, says, the mind must not be left to dwell at random upon every subject that the enemy of souls may suggest. We are so many times, I don't know if it happens to you, sometimes even in prayer. Have you ever started prayer and then suddenly you have to catch back your thought because you jump out of there right thinking about something else a few days? Does it happen to you? It happens to me many times. I have to sometimes, especially with the busy lives we have so many things to carry and do and things, and the devil is so smart that when we are kneeling for the prayer is when he says, hey, remember, you have to pay that bill. Oh, don't forget, you have to call that person. Oh, did you remember that you did such and such? Oh, look. And it's when you start thinking about everything. And I'm talking about healthy things. Now imagine about the things that Satan puts in our minds at random. And sometimes we go like in a cloud of thoughts. Isn't that? We are not supposed to let it happen. We shall seek for the freedom from those things, because the devil will bring all these kind of things for us to be under his hands. We are supposed to seek for the concentration in the Lord and what he wants from us. Now, there is another text that I wanted to share with you. And this one is found in My Life Today, 250. This is for me a very important text because it tells me about even the children when I had started educating them, what would be my main concern. It says, those who would not fall a prey to Satan's devices must guard well the avenues of the soul. They must avoid reading, seeing, or hearing that which will suggest impure thoughts. Do you see that? Reading, seeing, hearing. And interestingly, you know, nowadays our cell phones and our pads, those are called devices, right? It's interesting that back then, in 1800s, beginnings, we didn't have devices. But it's interesting that she uses the same word. I wouldn't take it as an as or word. I would think that it was very well placed. Whenever we have our devices in hands, let's remember that those devices may be very much used by Satan. Let us not read. Let us not see. And let us not hear things that may bring us impure thoughts. Why is that? Just because of the same things King David said in Psalms 101, verse 3. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. And I know why. You know why? When I looked at this that happened to me this week, when I saw that little thing on my phone, that disturbed me so much. I was so disturbed about what I saw. And it was like, you know, I didn't even want it to. I clicked it by, what is this? When I clicked on, it disturbed my whole week, thinking about what these people are really doing. So much harm to each other. It's like, Lord, is it true that these bad things happen out there and I'm not even aware? I'm trying to keep myself unaware of evil. And now it comes right away to my phone. I will set no wicked thing before my eyes, because those things stick to our minds for time and time and time. And we can't take them off by ourselves. It takes time. I remember things still nowadays that I saw when I was 4 years old. You would be amazed about it. But I still remember things like that that I should never have watched. And I know they interfered in my education. They interfered in my character building. Still time, brothers and sisters, still time for us to say the words of David. I will set no wicked thing before mine eyes. Let us clear and guard our avenues of the soul, our ears, our eyes, even our mouth, what we say and what we eat. We have to be so much careful because we don't understand that the truth will only set us free if we know the truth, if we mingle with the truth. If we just know the truth by passing by in such a way that I can point my finger to my brother and my sister saying, oh, they're not following the truth. the truth will not set me free, because the truth is supposed to be applied in my own life. There is no genuine, I want to share this with you as well, My Life Today, page 250 again. There is no genuine sanctification except through obedience to the truth. Again, like Brother Don was sharing in the Sabbath school, if this truth has no effect in my life, that is not a truth. If it is not doing something in my life, then it's useless. What do I need it for? Those who love God with all their heart will love all His commandments also. The sanctified heart is in harmony with the precepts of God's law, for they are holy, just, and good. If we are seeking for the real sanctification through the word and through the truth, we must obey that. And all of them are good. All of them are holy. And we will be in harmony with it. Now, this is what touches my heart. Those who, after receiving the truth, make no change, understand this. Those who, after receiving the truth, make no change, are living for themselves. Those who make no change are living for themselves and not for Christ. They have not been created anew in Jesus Christ and to purification and holiness. Nowadays, there is this happy clapping management of a church and spirituality. Just come. Jesus wants you as you are. That is true, as we were saying in the morning. That is true. Jesus is calling you as you are. But He is calling you to sanctify you by the truth, to change your whole being, your whole life, upside down, to get you back to the first beginning, the first thing we were, like Jesus. Yes, He accepted the thief on the cross the way He was. Of course, the thief on the cross didn't have time to do everything. He did what He could. And at that moment, He did what he could. And to each one of us, He's giving us a specific time. Right, David? He's giving us a time for us to do what we know, for us to follow the truth, for us to be with the truth, for us to know and live accordingly what we know. So we need to understand that those who, after receiving the truth, make no change are being just selfish. Jesus made the biggest change in His own life because of us. His life was turned upside down for us. He was the King, honored and loved from all, and came to be hated and mistreated as a poor person. So His life was supposed to be turned upside down, but ours cannot. How selfish. If we don't be careful about our own sanctification, and we think that what many people think, that when we talk about these things, is we're talking about salvation by works. No, we're not talking about salvation by works. We're talking about works as the fruit of salvation. Do you understand the difference? Many people think that we are saved by works. That is wrong. Some others think that we are just saved by grace and you have to do nothing. Just believe and you're fine. You're saved. None of them are right. The right thing is this. As you are saved in Christ and with the truth in you, you prove your works. Your works are according to the truth. And if you look at James 4, 17, 24, and 26, you will read this with me. And I would really invite you to take note of these texts and study them. Study them deeply at home. Think about it. Because that is something that really God really wants us to understand. We are not working our salvation by our merits. We are only saved by the merits of Jesus Christ and the cross for us. But his sacrifice should be an example for us of the little things that we are also supposed to do as loving children of God. And it says like this, James 4:17, then 24, then 26. I just put all together here. It says, even so, faith, if it had not worked, is dead, being alone. You see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. You understand that? By works a man is also justified and not by faith only. Why? Because works come alone, considering the faith you have. For as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. Now, don't take me wrong. Don't start doing things from yourself thinking that you're going to be saved because of that. It doesn't happen that way. God works in your life such a love for him, such a care for him, such a wish to please him, such a wish to be according to his will, that you start acting naturally like that. You start lifting his works, because those are his works in you as well. And do you know why do I say that so straight and with no fear? Because we have many examples in the Bible. We don't have one, we don't have two, we have plenty of that. Handfuls of examples of people who trusted Jesus and who believed in the truth, who were sanctified by the light they have, and finally had works according to that salvation. What do we talk about Zacchaeus? He was touched by the truth so much that a man that nobody could trust, nobody liked, he came back to their door and knocked and said, hey, I failed against you. I want to give it back, even more than what I did. Don't you think that is the power of the gospel? Changing lives? Well, Zacchaeus could keep doing his life. I mean, nobody liked him anyway. He could have just accepted Jesus and kept going. Why couldn't he? Because he needed to cast sin out of his life. What about the Samaritan woman? Jesus had the chance to come to her and say, listen, he didn't point his finger. That is a care that we have to have. He came to her with all love he could have. And he called her attention with all the love he could have. She felt so touched, she couldn't help. She ran back to her town and she said, couldn't be this one? The Messiah, the Christ, he said everything I did. Couldn't she be ashamed about it? She wouldn't have to tell anyone about it. She knew she had done so many things wrong. She was so excited about the truth and about salvation that she couldn't help. You can't believe it. He said every mistake I did, and he's so loving. Couldn't be that being the Messiah. Come see. Wouldn't she be better not to make a big fuss out of it and just keep living her life the way it was? The truth would have no effect on her. Salvation would just pass by. What about Mary Magdalene right here? Example of faithfulness. She was forgiven. And that forgiveness was so deep and strong in her life. So made such a big difference in her life that she couldn't help. She did something that nobody else would do. And many didn't even like. Some used the argument that, oh, Jesus, how can she, you know, use such an expensive thing for such a useless thing? I mean, this is so expensive. We could have sold it and make so much more money out of it. But she was doing something that nobody thought about. She was anointing him. She was being used by God for a special thing. And why was she doing it? It was expensive. She may have got, if you would, I didn't bring that in fact, but if you would see in the Bible how much that cost and how much a person would make a day, that was a year or more of work for her to have that little tiny thing, perfume, that she just used on Jesus. That is the power of the gospel. It changed her life that she became one of the most supportive things, persons in his ministry, to the point that she was right there when he was resurrected. She was so faithful because the truth set her free, free from her sins. Sins of that people have not only caught her on, but they have pushed her to. Sins that would have taken her to death. Jesus set her free. But now, would have it been fair if she wouldn't have changed? What did Jesus say to her? If we would say in her story, we found it in John 8, 1 to 11, then we find it again in Matthew 27, 61, then we find it again, her showing up in Luke 7, 37, 40, for those who want to check on her. If you would check on her life, what was the last thing Jesus said? Oh, nobody condemned you? I don't condemn you either. Go and sin no more. Why would he say that? Didn't he know she was in a sinful world? Didn't he know she had a sinful nature? What did he mean with that? He meant that even though you are slave of that nature, I came to save. Don't keep on that sinful life. Change your life. I'll be here. I'll be your helper. Change that bad life. And she became somebody totally different. Not to talk about Paul. Paul would be considered for us a person not to cross that door. What are you talking about, Paul? You came after many of us. You killed many of us. You put in jail many of us, and now you're coming and you want to preach? Excuse me. Why did he have that position he could preach? Because he changed his life. That is what conversion is all about. Conversion is not about falling in the water tank and coming back up. That is called baptism. Conversion may happen around that time. Conversion may happen before that time. Conversion means that I'm going in this direction and I'm finally going in this direction. I changed. I converted my ways. That is what Jesus is calling us to. That is what he's offering us to. Paul had a chance to witness in many places. He had the chance to show what the gospel did in his life. A change, a total change in his life. And that's what he's calling us to do as well. He's calling us to trust his word. To trust the truth. He is the truth. His word are the truth, is the truth. His commandments are the truth. This is what he's calling us to do. To follow his path so much that he may change our lives and make us new creatures in him. Because that's what he wants us to do. Imagine if all these people who are here, everybody selfish the way they are, everybody wanting life the way they are, going to heaven. Will that be called heaven? There is an image that you will never forget. Rebecca, come over here for me to get that image. You stay on that side, please. A little further so that you can be seen. I know that you wouldn't show the camera if you're not. So I'm right here. Rebecca's right there. We are a little bit distant to each other. Let's consider that the middle point here is Jesus. Okay? I want to get closer to Jesus. Rebecca wants to come closer to Jesus. Did we get close to each other? Do you think that getting closer to each other, we are more alike and we can deal with each other in a better way? That is what he's calling. If all of us get closer to Jesus, we all alike Jesus, we are all going to be fine with each other. We're all going to be good. We're all going to be good and trouble will be gone. Because if all look like Jesus, we're not going to be robots. Each one will have their own personality. But Jesus' character. I may like blue and Brenda may like red. But we are like Jesus. We like it like Jesus. You understand that? I really would like you to do and to say the same thing King David said. Thy word have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against thee. Thy word, thy truth, thy commandments, thy love, thy character have I hid in mine heart that I might not sin against you, that I may be just like you, that I may be in heaven with you, and it may be a rejoicing place, because there will be no tears, there will be no hurt, there will be no pain, because we are all like Jesus. I would like to invite you as we finish. I'd like to invite you, David, if you would help me with the piano, to sing with me, Trust and Obey. I think that this is one of the things that we must engrave in our hearts. Trust our Lord, obey our Lord, and trust that He is sanctifying our lives through His Word, through the truth. And that's why I wanted to bring that subject today, because it's such a complicated thing nowadays to find the truth. Everybody thinks they have some truth. We need the whole truth. We need total truth. We cannot afford to be in a tunnel so dark with a little flashlight trying to see the way. We want bright light. We all know the description of the end when Jesus comes, how it is going to be. Jesus will come and the light will be so big, so shining, so powerful. Light. True power. Every eye shall see it. I cannot imagine how Japan will see it the same time I will. But he said it will. It's going to be so shiny, so bright. So Jesus, everybody will see. The ones who are in darkness will plead to be able to hide. There's no way to hide from such a light. Let's trust the Lord. Obey the Lord, and He will set us free. I would like to invite you to stand with me as we sing together.
Thank you.
should get closer to this God that has made us and sanctify our lives, get us back to Him. So I would like to invite you, those who can and wish, that we may kneel before this powerful God, that we may subject our souls to Him, our minds. And as we pray, put yourselves in the hands of God today. He can solve anything. Anything in your life can be solved. Let's put that in His hands now as we close in prayer.
Father, once again we come to your presence. And Lord, we are so little. We are so weak. We have even a hard time to trust and obey. Please, Lord, build that in us. We want to ask you and give you the freedom to work in our hearts. Transform us, Lord, according to your will. We know that you know better than what we could ever know. Your word, your truth, please, Lord, use it to sanctify our lives, to unite us in you. We all have so many problems and so many issues in our own lives. We need you so much. Many of us have so many things in our plates here. We have so many family members and people who we love, who we wish they could see the need of this light and truth. Please, Lord, use us. Be in our lives in such a way that whenever we go, wherever we go, whoever we get in touch with, we may shine your light and your love. We are so tired of these lies in this world. Everybody wants to do their own way. It's hard to find the truth. Lord, we trust you because you are the truth. We believe you because you are the truth. Use that truth in our own lives today, I ask you, Lord. Purify us, even through the fire, that we may shine out like gold to this world in darkness, that we may be witnesses for you, and that we may support our brethren in faith. I pray, Lord, all these things, thanking you, for I know you hear us, for I know you know each individual life here, and that I know that your angels and your spirit have been in work for salvation. We are very thankful for your sacrifice, and we want to ask you that you may please work in our lives today and give us the chance to see the miracle of a changing life in our own lives so that we may be witnesses to the world who lost trust in the truth. I pray these things in Jesus' name and all his merits, his sacrifice, his holy name. Amen. As we leave now, I would like to invite Brother Don that he may usher us out orderly. I'm very happy today for we had Justin and Angela with us. I hope you have enjoyed being with us. And I pray that the Lord may keep us united throughout this journey, okay? May the Lord bless you and happy Sabbath.